Hi everyone, welcome again to the series of lectures on civil procedure on basic Philippine law and jurisprudence channel. Okay, our topic for today is parties to civil actions under Rule 3 of the revised rules on civil procedure. Okay. Just like actors and actresses in a movie, I will now introduce you to the players or the main characters in an ordinary or special civil action. So who are the parties to civil actions? The basic rule is for one to be considered as a party to a civil action, okay, he must be a natural person or a person clubbed with juridical personhood. Because Section 1 states that only natural persons or entities authorized by law may be parties in a civil action, in a civil action. So, who are those entities which are authorized by law that may be parties to a civil action? It can be the state and its political subdivisions, the local government units. It can be corporations, partnerships, institutions, and entities for public interest or purpose which are created by law. So with respect to corporations, they must be registered with the SEC and clubbed with a separate juridical personality from its stockholders. Natural persons, it can be any person as long as that person is still alive. Because once that person is already dead, then he is no longer capable of being a party to a civil action. Okay. We have the case of Alliance of Quezon City Homeowners versus the Quezon City Government. Okay. So, we have this case. This is a case for a preliminary injunction which questioned the constitutionality of an ordinance. Okay. Now, respondent Alliance questioned. Okay, the said ordinance. However, the respondent, Quezon City, countered that Alliance has no legal capacity to sue since its certificate of registration as a corporation was revoked by the SEC. The rules of court mandates that only natural or juridical persons or entities authorized by law may be parties in a civil action. Non-compliance with this requirement renders the case dismissible. So, Alliance is in this case is an okay. In this case, it was filed by Alliance and not by the individual members of its board of trustees. So, considering that Alliance is not registered with the Securities and Exchange Commission, okay, jurisprudence provides that an unregistered association having no juridical personality lacks the capacity to sue in its own name. So in this case, Alliance admitted that it has no juridical personality considering the revocation of its SEC certificate of registration and its failure to register with the HLURB as a homeowners association. Let us now go to the case of Berman Memorial Park versus Cheng. Okay, so just like the case of Wasim Hardware, which you will later learn when we go to persons and family relations. A sole proprietorship is not vested with juridical personality and cannot sue or file or defend an action. So unlike corporations, partnerships, okay, a sole proprietorship is not clothed with juridical personality, and therefore an action cannot be filed, nor can he be summoned as a defendant in a civil action. It does not possess a juridical personality separate and distinct from the personality of the owner of the enterprise. So if you have a sole proprietorship, then the owner of the sole proprietorship has to file the civil action, or if he is a defendant, then the summons should be directed to the owner of the sole proprietorship and not to the sole proprietorship itself. So it is only a business name used by BMPI for the memorial park it owned and operated. So it is BMPI which has the juridical personality to be sued by the respondent. Indeed, the real party in interest as party defendant in the RTC is BMPI, the signatory to the said agreement. So I think they sued the IMP and not BMPI in this case. If the real party in interest as defendant is not implicated, then the complaint must be dismissed on the ground that it states no cause of action. So the moral lesson for the case of Berman Memorial Park is that a sole proprietorship is bereft of any juridical personality. So you have to sue the owner of the sole proprietorship and not the sole proprietorship itself. Okay, let us now move to the case of Philippine Numismatic and Antiquarian Society versus Aguilera. Okay, every action must be prosecuted or defended in the name of the real party in interest. Okay, so what is the rationale or reason, okay, for requiring that the real party in interest must be made a party to the case? Okay. The reason is to prevent the prosecution of actions by persons without any right, title, or interest in the case. Second, to require the actual party entitled to relief to be the one to prosecute the action. Third, it is to avoid multiplicity of suits. And fourth, to discourage litigation. Okay, you can just imagine if suits can be brought by anyone, then anyone would be free to harass any person by filing unlimited suits, even if he is not really interested in the suit. Okay, so that is the reason why below, or the rules rather, require that the person filing the action must be a real party in interest. Okay? To bring before the rule is intended to bring before the court the party rightfully interested in the litigation so that only real controversies will be presented and the judgment will be binding and conclusive upon the defendant. So in this case, PINAS as a corporation is the real party in interest because its personality is distinct and separate from the personalities of its stockholders. It necessarily follows that an individual corporate officer cannot solely exercise any corporate power pertaining to the corporation without authority from the board of directors. So in this case, it is the corporation itself, which has a personality separate from the stockholders, which is the real party in interest. Since petitioner is a corporation, the certification attached and filed with the RTC must be executed by the officer or member of the board or by one who is duly authorized by a resolution of the board. Otherwise, the complaint will have to be dismissed. Remember, a corporation acts through its board of directors. So whoever is the one who filed the case, if it is a corporation, there has to be a secretary certificate or a board resolution, okay, authorizing the person who filed the same to file it in behalf of the corporation. Now, the petitioner's failure to submit proof that Attorney Villarreal has been authorized by DINAS to file the complaint is a sufficient ground for the dismissal. So remember, even if a corporation is authorized by law to file or defend civil actions, okay, the person who files the suit must be authorized by the corporation to its board of directors to file the same suit. Otherwise, if there is no authorization in the form of a board resolution or a secretary certificate, then it could be vulnerable to dismissal on the ground of lack of cause of action. But you must remember that failure to state a cause of action is actually the ground. Okay? But considering that it is no longer a ground for dismissal under the rules, okay, what you must do is that you can move for a judgment on the pleadings or a motion for summary judgment. We have the case of Duenas versus Santos Subdivision Homeowners Association. The petitioner claims that the respondent failed to present any evidence that it is a legally organized juridical entity authorized to sue or be sued. Okay, SSHA counters that it has the capacity to sue as an association since it is a member of the Federation of Valenzuela Homeowners, which is registered with the SEC. Okay, there is merit in petitioner's contention. Only natural or juridical persons or entities authorized by law may be parties in a civil action. An association is considered a juridical person if the law grants it a personality separate and distinct from that of its members. So the records of the case are bare of any showing that SSHA is an association duly organized under Philippine law. So the mere fact that SSHA is a member of the Federation of Valenzuela Homeowners, which is registered with the SEC, does not mean that it becomes an entity vested with juridical personality just by the mere fact of its membership with a SEC registered association. It has to file a separate application with the SEC so that it can be an entity which is authorized by law to sue or be sued. Fact showing the capacity of a party to sue or be sued or the authority of a party to sue or be sued in a representative capacity for the legal existence of an organized association of persons that is made a party must be averred for failing to show that it is a juridical entity endowed by law with capacity to bring suits in its own name. SSHA is devoid of any legal capacity to file the action. Okay, now we go to section 2. Who are parties in interest? We have already previously discussed this in the case of Philippine numismata. A real party in interest is the party who will be benefited or injured by the judgment in the suit or the party entitled to the avails of the suit. Every action must be prosecuted or defended in the name of the real party in interest. In other words, the party who is most interested in the action. Okay, so the filing of the action will either benefit him or will injure him. Okay, now, can there be representative parties to the action? Section 3 states that when the action is allowed to be prosecuted or defended by a representative or someone acting in a fiduciary capacity, the beneficiary shall be included in the title of the case and shall be deemed to be the real party of interest. So, for example, Juan de la Cruz as agent of or as representative of Pedro Santos. Okay. A representative may be a trustee of an express trust, a guardian, an executor or administrator, or a party authorized by law for these rules. How about spouses? Should they be joined, okay, both in a suit? Okay, we have the so-called nominal parties. Okay, but as a rule, husband and wife shall sue or be sued jointly, except as provided by law. Why? Because as you know, the default property regime is absolute community of property. So, husband and wife are treated as one entity. Okay, so that is the reason why the law requires that if you are suing a married person, you should also sue the wife as a nominal party. Okay? And if you are also filing a case and you are a married person, okay, you should sue not by yourself, but you should join also your spouse as a nominal party. How about minors or incompetent persons? A minor or a person alleged to be incompetent may sue or be sued with the assistance of his father, mother, guardian, or if he has none, a guardian, ad libitum. But it must also be reflected in the title of the suit that he is suing as a guardian of the minor. Now, what is permissive joining of parties? All persons in whom or against whom any right to relief in respect to or arising out of the same transaction or series of transactions is alleged to exist, whether jointly or severally, or in the alternative, may join as plaintiffs or be joined as defendants in one complaint where there is any question of law or fact common to all such plaintiffs or to all such defendants may arise in the action. So if there is joinder of causes of action, there can also be joinder of parties. Okay, the only requirement of the law, of the rules, is that there must be a common question of law or fact, okay, arising from the action. The purpose of joinder of parties, joinder of causes of action, is to include or to resolve in one case, okay, all the issues, okay, all the parties that are interested, so as that there will be no duplication in the presentation of evidence and to avoid multiplicity of suits. What if there is a necessary party that was not joined in the action? The general rule is that in all cases, indispensable parties must be joined in the action. How about necessary parties? As much as possible, you must also join all the necessary parties in the action. What if one of the necessary parties was not joined? It is a requirement that you should state that in your pleading. Section 9 of Rule 3 states that whenever in a pleading in which a claim is asserted, a necessary party is not joined, the pleader shall set forth his name and shall state why he was omitted. If the court finds the reason for the omission unmeritorious, it may order the inclusion of the omitted necessary party if jurisdiction over his person can be obtained. Failure to comply with this order without justifiable cause shall be deemed a waiver of the claim against such party. Okay, however, the non-inclusion of a necessary party does not prevent the court from proceeding the action. So unlike indispensable parties, if the person that was not included is only a necessary party, it does not prevent the court from rendering a valid judgment. But if there is a failure of the plaintiff to comply with the order of the court, shall be deemed a waiver of his right against that necessary party who was not included in the action. Okay? So what do you mean by interest? Okay, because it is a requirement that every action must be prosecuted or defended in the name of the real party. So actually, a real party in interest is an indispensable party to the suit. What is interest? Interest means material interest or an interest to be affected by the decree or judgment, as distinguished from mere curiosity about the question in court. Okay. Now, who are, what are the classes of real parties in interest? Of course, the plaintiff, the one who initiated the complaint. It refers to the claiming party, the one who filed the case, the counterclaimant with respect to the defendant in his answer, the cross-claimant, the third fourth party plaintiff. Okay, it refers to the party claiming relief. The defendant, it refers to the original defending party, the defendant in the counterclaim, the cross-defendant, or the third or fourth party defendant. Okay. There can also be a third party plaintiff. The defending party may sue another who is not a party to the original action for contribution, indemnity, subrogation, or any other relief in respect to his opponent's claim. When leave to file third party complaint is granted, the court renders judgment in the same case, one in the main complaint and another on the third party complaint. The purpose is to avoid multiplicity of suits. However, there must be a causal connection between the claim in the main complaint and the claim for contribution against the third party defendant. We have the case of Allied Banking versus Court of Appeals. Yuwiko obtained a loan from GenBank. Okay, and he executed the corresponding promissory. So the Monetary Board of the Central Bank issued a resolution forbidding GenBank from doing business in the Philippines and ordered the liquidation of GenBank. Allied, on the other hand, acquired all the assets and assumed the liabilities of GenBank, which includes the receivable from Yuwiko. Now, upon failing to comply with his obligations under the loan, Allied filed a complaint against Yuwiko for the collection of a sum of money. Okay. And then, Yuwiko, on the other hand, filed a motion to admit third-party complaint against the Central Bank, okay, as third-party defendants. Yuwiko alleged that by reason of the tortious interference by the Central Bank with the affairs of GenBank, Yuwiko was prevented from performing his obligations under the law. Because GenBank was closed, right? It was subjected to liquidation. And because of that action of the Central Bank, according to Yuwiko, he was prevented from fulfilling his obligations under the loan agreement. Okay, so the important thing to remember in the case of Allied Bank is, what is a third party complaint? It is actually independent of, and it is a procedural device whereby a third party who is neither a party nor a privy to the act complained of by the plaintiff may be brought into the case with leave of court. Remember, the central bank was not a party to the original action. It was only Allied Bank and UWICO. Now, UWICO filed the third party complaint against the central bank. Okay. So the third party complaint is actually independent of, separate and distinct from the plaintiff's complaint, such that it would have to be filed separately from the original complaint by the defendant against the third party. The third party plaintiff's claim is premised not only on what was alleged as tortious interference by the third party defendants with the affairs of GenBank, it is wedded to a decision rendered by the CA finding the liquidation of GenBank as arbitrary and made in bad faith, and therefore the same must be annulled and set aside. Okay. Let us now move to the case of West Tower Tondo versus FPIC. Okay, this case involves the gas leak in the Makati area. Okay, the issue is whether the petitioner, West Tower, has the legal capacity and whether the other petitioners, apart from the residents of West Tower and Barangay Bangkal, are real parties in interest. A real party in interest is one who stands to be benefited or injured by the judgment in the suit. In the case of Bar, there can be no quibble that the oil leak from the affected all the condominium unit owners and the residents of West Tower. Thus, there is no gainsaying that the residents of West Tower are real parties in interest. There can also be no denying that West Tower Corporation represents the common interest of its unit owners and residents, and has the legal standing to file the subject petition. It is empowered to pursue actions on behalf of its members. So, in this case, they are the real parties in interest because they are the one who is greatly affected by the oil leak. And thus, they are the ones who are most interested in bringing the action. With respect to the residents of the Barangay Bangkal, they are similarly situated with the unit owners and residents of West Tower. And if they wish, they could also join the petitioners. Okay. Minors, they may sue or be sued through their parents, guardian, or guardian ad litem. Okay, and the same is true with respect to incompetence. Again, nominal parties with respect to spouses, they must sue or be sued jointly. They are sued jointly because they are considered as co-administrators of the community property. What is the difference between indispensable and necessary parties? Okay, with respect to indispensable parties, they must be joined compulsory or mandatory. They must be included in the suit. What is the reason why they have to be included in the suit? In order to bind them, in order to make the decision or the judgment of the court binding on them. Okay. These are the parties in interest without whom no final determination can be had of an action. Okay. These are indispensable parties. Okay. On the other hand, a necessary party is one who is not indispensable, but who should be joined as a party if complete relief is to be accorded as to those already parties. or for a complete determination or settlement of the claim subject of action. As we have said a while ago, if there is a necessary party who is not included as a party to the action, the plaintiff must state the reason why. Now, if the court finds the reason to be without merit, then the court can order that party to be joined in the action. If the plaintiff refuses, then he waives his right to the said necessary party. What is the so-called unwilling or plaintiff? So if the consent of any party who should be joined as plaintiff cannot be obtained, he may be made a defendant, and the reason for it shall be stated in the complaint. Again, remember that with respect to indispensable parties, their joinder in the action is compulsory. The legal presence of an indispensable party is an absolute necessity. The absence of an indispensable party renders all actions of the court void for want of authority to act, not only as to the absent parties, but also as to those present. However, the non-joinder of indispensable party is not a ground for dismissal of an action. The remedy is to implead the non-party claim to be indispensable. In the same manner, the non-inclusion of a necessary party does not automatically result in the dismissal of a civil action. The court may order the inclusion of a necessary party if jurisdiction over his person can be obtained. However, if the plaintiff refuses to implead the necessary party despite the order of the court, the action may be dismissed for failure to comply with the said order. We have the case of Heirs of Dinglasan versus Ayala Corporation. Okay. Again, the court reiterates that with respect to indispensable parties, their joinder is mandatory. Okay. Courts cannot proceed without their presence. Okay. It is necessary to vest jurisdiction in the court. Okay, why? Because these are the parties who are most interested in the action. It is imperative that indispensable parties must be joined in the action to make the judgment in the suit binding. Okay, in this case, Severina Luna Orosa is an indispensable party because the main issue is whether or not the issuance of the title, which was alleged to be registered under Orosa's name, was fraudulently obtained. Okay, so that is he is the registered owner, and his ownership is being questioned because according to the plaintiff, his title was fraudulently obtained. That is the reason why the registered owner, Rosa, is an indispensable party to the action. Okay. They are claiming that there are badges of fraud which accompany the issuance of the title. The parties in a better position to defend this accusation are the Orosas. So any decision rendered would affect them. They are entitled to be heard to defend the validity of their title. It is clear that Orosa's rights are directly affected by the controversy and that she stands to be injured by the outcome of the complaint. In fine, the absence of Orosa in the complaint filed by the petitioner renders all subsequent actions null and void for want of authority to act, not only as to the absent parties, but even as to those present. Non-joinder of indispensable parties is not a ground for dismissal of an action. The remedy is to include the non-party claim to be indispensable. Parties may be added by order of the court on motion of the party or motum quo. Okay, let us now go to the case of Living at Sense versus Malayan Insurance. So in this case, petitioner was the contractor of Globe. Okay, it entered into a subcontract agreement with DMI, under which the latter was, DMI was tasked to undertake an underground open trench work. Now, the petitioner required DMI to give a performance bond. DMI secured surety and performance bond with Malayan Insurance Company. Okay. In the insurance bond, they bound themselves jointly and severally liable with DMI. Now, the DPWH issued a work stoppage order against DMI, finding the work of DMI to be unsatisfactory. Now, petitioner sought indemnification from Malayan, okay, because of the performance and surety bond that it gave in, it gave in favor of DMI. Now, Malayan denied petitioner's claim on the ground that the liability of DMI should first be ascertained before its own liability as surety attaches. Now, seeking the dismissal of the complaint, respondent claimed, Malayan claimed that DMI is an indispensable party that should be included and whose liability should first be determined before he can be held liable under the surety agreement. Okay. The Supreme Court said disagreed. Okay, why? Because respondent bound itself jointly and severally with DMI for the damages. The term jointly and severally expresses a solidarity obligation, granting the creditor the right to proceed against its debtors, Malayan or DMI. So the nature of the solidarity obligation under the surety does not make one an indispensable party. So the petitioner is free to choose who to sue, either DMI or Malayan, okay, because of the joint and solidarity liability. So in this case, DMI is not an indispensable party because petitioner can claim indemnity directly from the respondent, having made itself jointly and severally liable with DMI for the obligation under the bonds. Therefore, failure to include DMI is not a ground to dismiss the case. Remember, the Supreme Court reiterated that failure to include an indispensable party is not a ground for dismissal. The remedy is to include the party claim to be indispensable, considering that parties may be added at any stage of action. Divinang Gracia versus Parilla. So in this case, the issue is whether or not the CA correctly ruled that Pelcon's siblings are indispensable parties to Santiago's complaint for judicial partition. Okay, and whether and dismiss Santiago's complaint for his failure to include the omitted heirs. Remember, class, in an action for partition, okay, the rules require that all compulsory heirs must be included or included in the action. With regard to action for partition, Section 1, Rule 69 requires that all persons interested in the property shall be joined as defendants. Thus, all co-heirs or persons having an interest in the property are indispensable parties. As such, an action for partition will not lie without the joinder of the said parties. However, a reading of the complaint shows that as regards Mateo Sr.'s interest, only Pelcon was included, excluding his siblings and co-representatives. Verily, Santiago's commission of the said years renders his complaint for partition defective. The absence of the indispensable parties in the complaint for judicial partition renders all subsequent actions null and void for want of authority to act not only as to the absent parties, but even as to those persons. In instances of non-joinder of indispensable parties, the proper remedy is to entreat them and not to dismiss the case. Okay, we have the case of Carandang versus Digsma. The spouses Carandang claim that since three of the four checks were issued in the name of Digsman, the latter should be considered as an indispensable party. Being such, they claim that the failure to join Digsman as plaintiff should cause the dismissal of the action. Okay. Remember that failure to comply with the order for inclusion without justifiable cause shall be deemed a waiver of the claim against such party. Okay, in this case, the Supreme Court ruled that De Guzman is not an indispensable party, but only a necessary party. Okay, so with respect to necessary parties, okay, if there is an order of the court to plead the said necessary party, but the plaintiff still failed to comply with the said order, then the judgment of the court is without prejudice to the rights of the said party. The non-inclusion of a necessary party does not prevent the court from proceeding with the action, and the judgment therein shall be without prejudice to the rights of the necessary party. Okay, again, non-compliance with the order for the inclusion of a necessary party would not warrant the dismissal of the complaint. It shall not prevent the court from proceeding in the action, and the judgment rendered therein shall be without prejudice to the rights of such necessary. Such non-joinder is not a ground for dismissal. The failure to join the spouse in that case was not a jurisdictional defect. The non-joinder of a spouse does not warrant dismissal, as it is merely a formal requirement which may be cured by amendment. Okay. With respect to a co-owned property, all co-owners are actually real parties in interest. But is it necessary to join all of them? Okay. Article 487 states that only one of the co-owners, namely the co-owner who filed the suit, is an indispensable party. The other co-owners are not. They're not even necessary parties, since the suit is presumed to have been filed for the benefit of all the co-owners. In this case, De Guzman is not an indispensable party in the action for the recovery of the loaned money. As such, he need not have been impeded, and the dismissal of the suit is not warranted by her not being a party. Yeah. So we have the case of Senyo versus Mangabat. The trial court ordered to be impeded as defendants Andres Evangelista and Magubat on the ground that they are indispensable parties. So plaintiffs filed an amended complaint to comply with the directive of the court. Now the issue is whether or not Andres and Bienvenido are indispensable parties. Okay. In this case, there are no rights of defendants Andres and Bienvenido to be safeguarded if the sale should be held to be in fact an absolute sale, nor if the sale is to be held to be an equitable mortgage. Defendant Mangubat became the absolute owner of the property by virtue of the sale to him of the shares of the aforementioned defendants in the property. said defendants no longer have any interest in the subject property. However, being parties to the instrument sought to be returned, their presence is necessary in order to settle all the possible issues of the controversy. In other words, they are only necessary parties. Why? Because they are no longer the registered owners of the property. Okay? Whether the disputed sale be declared an absolute sale or an equitable mortgage, the rights of all the defendants will have been amply protected. It was only because they were ordered by the court that they be included in the complaint. The lower court erroneously held that the said defendants are indispensable parties. Okay, we have the case of Emata versus Alia. In this case, petitioner Emata purchased a car on installment from Biolago. Okay, now Emata executed a promissory note and a chattel mortgage over the car as security for the loan obligation. Biolago endorsed the promissory note and assigned the chattel mortgage to Philinvest. And then later on, Philinvest assigned to Service-Wide Specialist or SSI the remaining installment balance. Now, alleging non-payment of installments, Service-Wide initiated the case for a writ of replevant to seize the car. Now, petitioner Emata filed a motion to implead Philinvest, okay, on the ground that it is a real party in interest. Remember, Philinvest assigned the collectible, okay, to Service-Wide Specialist. Petitioner, however, did not file any third-party complaint. So, Emata complains that the trial court heard in requiring him to file a complaint against Philinvest instead of impeding the latter either as an unwilling party plaintiff or defendant. The Philinvest position and the evidence was that it was not a real party in interest as it was no longer entitled to the avails of the suit by reason of the anterior assignment it made in favor of SSI. So the option lies with the plaintiff on whether or not to join an additional party in his complaint. The original plaintiff cannot be compelled on the mere representations of the defendant to implead anyone, especially if it does not appear that such jointer is proper or is necessary for the case. So, because of the fact that Philinvest already assigned the collectible to SSI, is no longer interested in the suit. Okay? So that is the reason why there is no more need to plead him because he was not a real party in interest. Okay? The important thing to remember with respect to permissive joinder of parties is that it may be made if there is a common question of fact or law, which is the issue for all the plaintiffs or the defendants in the action. Okay? We have the case of Cameron Granville versus Chua. In this case, the respondents, Chua, obtained a loan from Metrobank. The loan was secured by a real estate mortgage. Now, because of default in the payment of the loan, Metrobank foreclosed extrajudicially the mortgage. Now, the respondents filed a motion to admit amended complaint for the annulment of foreclosure of mortgage, declaration of nullity of the certificate of sale, and injunction. Now, petitioner filed a motion for joinder of party and on substitution. It alleged that by virtue of the deed of absolute sale, Metrobank sold to Asia Recovery its credit against Cameron, against Chua, including all the rights therein. ARC, on the other hand, ARC, assigned the credit to petitioner Cameron through a deed of assignment. So there was a series of assignments from Metrobank to ARC, then from ARC to Cameron. Now, the RDC granted the motion and ordered the petitioner to be joined as party defendant, but without dropping Metrobank as defendant. Okay, now, the issue is whether the CA was correct in allowing the joinder of the petitioner in this case. Okay. The rationale for joinder of parties is that the rationale for allowing parties to join the proceeding that delves on a common question of law or fact concerning them is trial convenience. Save the parties necessary work, trouble, and expense. In order to meet the requirements of justice and convenience, the rule on the joinder of parties is construed with considerable flexibility. Hence, courts are given broad discretion in determining who may be properly joined in the proceeding. Okay, the rules also provide that in case of transfer of interest, the court may, upon motion, redirect the person to whom the interest is transferred to be substituted in the action or joined with the original party. Okay. Nevertheless, whether or not the transferee should be substituted should be addressed to the sound discretion of the court. For the CA to say that as between Metrobank and the petitioner, only one of them is clothed with personality is to show a regrettable lack of understanding of the rules and an unwarranted restriction of the trial court's discretion. We now go back to the case of Franco versus Standard Insurance. Well, this case was previously discussed when we were in the topic of joinder of causes of action. So again, there was Chris Crispy, who was driving a passenger jeepney which was owned by his mother along the national highway. Suddenly, it was bumped by a Pantranco bus driven by Alexander. Okay. The total cost of the repair was 21,415, but the respondent Standard paid only 8,000. Okay, to Martina, the owner of the jeepney, which was insured. Martina shouldered the balance of 13,000. Thus, they filed against Pantranco and Alexander the amounts of 8,000 for Standard and 13,000 for Martina. Okay, petitioners insist that the trial court has no jurisdiction since the cause of action did not arise from the same transaction and that there are no common questions of law and fact common to both parties. Remember that there is a single transaction common to all, and that is Pantranco's bus hitting the rear side of the jeep. There is also a common question of fact, whether petitioners are negligent. There being a single transaction common to both respondents, they have the same cause of action. Determine identity of cause of action, it must be ascertained whether the evidence necessary to sustain the second cause of action would have been sufficient to authorize a recovery in the first. In this case, had respondents filed a separate suit, the same evidence would have been presented to sustain the same cause of action. Remember that test in determining whether there is a common question of fact or law is that if the same evidence would be presented even though there are several cases. So if it would require presentation of the same evidence, then it can be joined not only as to causes of action, but also as to parties. Okay? Now, what is a class suit? We now go to a class suit. When the subject matter of the controversy is of common or general interest to many persons, so numerous that it is impractical to join all the parties, a number of them which the court finds to be sufficiently numerous and representative as to fully protect the interest of all concerned, may sue or defend for the benefit of any party in interest shall have the right to intervene to protect his individual interests. Okay. How about if you do not know who is really liable? Okay. We have the case of alternative defendants. When the plaintiff is not certain against whom several persons is entitled to relief, he may join any or all of them as defendants in the alternative, although the a right to relief against one may be inconsistent with a right to relief against the other. Okay? Remember the previous case that we have discussed regarding EMI and the solidary liability of Malayan and DMI. So the suit was filed only against Malayan. So in that case, there can also be alternative defendants. Okay, if you do not know whom to sue, but in that case, the obligation was joint and solidary. So you may sue any one of them because of the joint and solidary liability. What if the defendant is not known? How do you sue him? So Section 14 tells us that whenever the identity or name of the defendant is not known, he may be sued as an unknown holder, heir, devisee, or by such other designation as the case may require. When his identity or true name is discovered, the pleading must be amended accordingly. Okay? An entity without juridical personality. Okay, can you sue them? Section 15 tells us that when two or more persons not organized as an entity with juridical personality enter into a transaction, they may be sued under the name by which they are generally known. In the answer of such defendant, the names and addresses of the persons composing said entity must all be revealed. What is a derivative suit? Derivative suit is the right of a stockholder to sue in behalf of the corporation as an effective remedy of the minority against the abuses of management. Remember that a corporation acts through its board of directors. What if there is abuse committed by the board of directors? Okay, and the stockholder wants to sue in behalf of the corporation. Okay, we have the derivative suit. Okay, this is the right of a stockholder to sue in behalf of the corporation as a remedy of the minority against the abuses of management. Okay, the individual stockholder may file a derivative suit in behalf of the corporation where he has stocks in order to protect or vindicate corporate rights whenever officials of the corporation refuse to sue or are the ones to be sued. With such action, suing stockholder is a nominal party while the corporation is the real party in interest. A class suit is defined as a species, a of a representative suit insofar as the persons who represent the entire class of persons have the same interest or suffered the same injury. Now, it can prosper. A class suit will prosper only the following are present. When the subject matter of the controversy is of common or general interest to many persons, when such persons are so numerous, it is impractical to join all of them. When such persons are sufficiently numerous as to represent and protect fully the interest of all concerned. We have the case of one complex homeowners versus Phil Estate. So in this case, one complex homeowners association together with its residents filed a complaint for damages. They represent in its own behalf and as a class suit, representing the regular commuters and motorists of Juana Complex and neighboring subdivisions. Okay, so they allege that they were regular commuters and motorists who constantly traveled towards the direction of Manila and Calamba, that they use the entry and exit toll gates of Exles by passing through the right-of-way public road known as La Paz Road, that they had been using La Paz Road for more than 10 years, and that Phil Estate excavated, broke, and deliberately ruined La Paz Road that led to Exles. So if you are familiar with the South Luzon Expressway, okay, when you're coming from Manila, you have to pass through a privately owned subdivision. Okay, there is this portion that passes through the privately owned subdivision. That was the subject of this going to Calamba. Okay. Now, in this case, the issue is whether the complaint has been properly filed as a class suit. Okay, so the case of Juana Complex also discussed the requirements for a class suit to prosper, and the court positively declared that the suit is clearly one that benefits all the commuters and motorists who use La Paz Road. The subject matter of the case, the closure and excavation of the La Paz Road, was initially shown to be of common or general interest to many persons. Numerous individuals have had manifestations conveying their intention to join the suit and claiming that they are similarly situated. The individuals sought to be represented are so numerous that it is impractical to join them all as parties and to be named individually in the complaint. Okay? We now move to the case of Ago Realty versus Ago. The issue in this case is whether or not Emmanuel may sue in behalf of ARDC absent a resolution or authority from the board. Okay. Again, this is a derivative suit where the board of directors itself is a party to the wrong, either because it is the author or because it refuses to take remedial action. Equity permits individual stockholders to file the case. This action is known as a derivative suit. In derivative suits, it is the corporation that is the victim of the wrong. As such, it is the corporation that is regarded as the real party in interest, while the stockholder is only a nominal party. The judgment rendered in the suit must constitute res judicata against the corporation, even though it refuses to sue through its board of directors. Okay? The right of the stockholders to bring their derivative suits is a right that is implied by the fiduciary duties that directors owe corporations. Derivative suits are therefore grounded on equity. Okay? substitution of parties. If a party dies while the suit is pending, okay, what should you do? So whenever a party to a pending action dies and the claim is not extinguished, it shall be the duty of the council within 30 days from the death of the party to give the name and address of his legal representative. Failure to comply with this duty shall be a ground for disciplinary action. The heirs of the deceased may be allowed to be substituted for the deceased without requiring the appointment of an executor or administrator. Okay. If no legal representative is named by the council for the deceased party, or if the one named fails to appear, the court may order the opposing party to procure the appointment of an executor or administrator for the estate, and the latter shall immediately appear for or on behalf of the deceased. Okay, so there is no necessity to immediately require the opposing party to file a case for settlement of estate. So, upon information given by the council as to who are the heirs of the party to die, okay, then they may be substituted. Okay, substituted in the place of the deceased party. How about in case of death or separation of a party who is a public officer? When a public officer is a party in an action in his official capacity and during its pendency dies, resigns, or ceases to hold office, the action may be continued and maintained against his successor if within 30 days after the successor takes office or such time as may be granted by the court. Okay. We have the case of Berot versus Shamno. In this case, Makaria and spouses Berot obtained a loan from Shamno, and as security, Lilia mortgaged a portion of land. Subsequently, Makaria died. Now, because of the default, they actually filed an action for foreclosure and damages. In an answer, appellant argued that the lower court has no jurisdiction over Makaria for the reason that there was no summons because he was already dead at the time when the action was filed. The complaint was later on amended by substituting the estate of Makaria in her stead. Appellant contends that the substitution of the estate of Makaria for her is improper, as the estate has no legal personality to be sued. Okay. A deceased person does not have such legal entity as is necessary to bring action, so much so that a motion to substitute cannot lie. An action begun by a decedent's estate cannot be said to have been begun by a legal person, since an estate is not a legal entity. A decedent does not have the capacity to be sued. He may not be named as a party defendant in a court action. So the moral of the story is that when a party to the action is already dead, you can no longer sue him. So the summons that is issued against him would not be considered as a valid service or summons. It is then the duty of the council to inform the court of the names of the heirs of the said deceased party. Okay? Petitioners need not object when Makaria was included as a respondent in the foreclosure case. Berot did not object either when the original complaint was amended. Thus, the trial and the appellate courts were correct in ruling that petitioners impliedly waived any objection to the trial court's exercise of jurisdiction over their persons at the inception of the case. For the case to continue, The real party in interest must be substituted for the deceased. The real party in interest is the one who will be affected by the judgment. It could be the administrator or executor or the heirs. In this case, the heirs are the proper substitute. Substitution is important because such opportunity to defend is a requirement to comply with due process. Such substitution consists of making the proper changes in the caption of the case, which may be called the formal aspect. Such substitution also includes the process of letting the substitutes know that they shall be bound by any judgment in the case and that they should therefore actively participate in the defense of the deceased. Diligent party. In case one of the parties is unindigent, okay, he may file an ex parte application that the party has no money or this money is not sufficient file the suit. Okay, now, the authority shall include exemption from payment of docket and other lawful fees and of transcript or stenography. Substitution of parties. If a party through independency of the action becomes incompetent, incapacitated, the court upon motion with notice may allow the action to be continued by or against the incompetent or incapacitated person assisted by his legal guardian. Okay. What if there is a transfer of interest? In case of transfer of interest, the action may be continued by or against the original party unless the court, upon motion, directs the person to whom the interest is transferred to be substituted in the action or joined with the original party. So that's it for parties to civil actions. Thank you for listening and don't forget to subscribe.